السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإن كنتم في ريب مما نزلنا على عبدنا فأتوا بسورة من مثله وادعوا شهداءكم من دون الله إن كنتم صادقين. فإن لم تفعلوا ولن تفعلوا فاتقوا النار التي وقودها الناس والحجارة أعدت للكافرين. وبشر الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات أن لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار كلما رزقوا منها من ثمرة رزقا قالوا هذا الذي رزقنا من قبل وأتوا به متشابها ولهم فيها أزواج مطهرة وهم فيها خالدون. إن الله لا يستحيي أن يضرب مثلا ما بعوضة فما فوقها فأما الذين آمنوا فيعلمون أنه الحق من ربهم وأما الذين كفروا فيقولون ماذا أراد الله بهذا مثلا يضل به كثيرا ويهدي به كثيرا وما يضل به إلا الفاسقين الذين ينقضون عهد الله من بعد ميثاقه ويقطعون ما أمر الله به أن يوصل ويفسدون في الأرض أولئك هم الخاسرون. كيف تكفرون بالله وكنتم أمواتا فأحياكم ثم يميتكم ثم يحييكم ثم إليه ترجعون. هو الذي خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا ثم استوى إلى السماء فسواهن سبع سماوات وهو بكل شيء عليم. صدق الله العظيم. Today we are studying from ayah number 23, which is a challenge to disbelievers. And it's a proof of the truthfulness of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In ayah number 21, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited all mankind towards worshipping Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Invited everyone towards believing in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presented the proof of His oneness and His existence, and that is number one, that He is Rabb. Which means if any person would think about who created me, who created this universe, who created everything in this universe, would realize that there is a creator and there is a sustainer, there is someone who is the caretaker of this whole universe. It's not that all of a sudden everything fell in place and they continue to be the way they are now. Just like Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, once he was approached by some people who did not believe in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said, I would come to your town for a debate. When he was going there was a river from his town to the town where those people used to live. And he had to cross it with a boat. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah arrived very late to that appointment. When he got there, he apologized to those people for being late. And he said, the reason for me being late is, when I came over there, there was no boat. I couldn't find any boat to cross the river. And I'm thinking, how I'm going to cross this river if there is no boat? While I'm standing there, and I was standing just next to a tree, all of a sudden I saw the tree was getting cut by itself. The tree was getting cut into small pieces. It became planks. Then, all of a sudden, to my surprise, I saw that these planks are getting together. All of these planks are getting together, and then they started shaping in a form like a boat. And then all of a sudden, within no time, it became a perfect boat that came and stood in front of me. It just drove by itself. It went into the water and it stood in front of me. So I knew it stands over there for me. It came there for me. So I sat on it. No one is driving it. It started moving by itself and came and brought me over here. This is how I came to you people. When he mentioned this, those people who did not believe in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, they said, this is not possible. How could you say that a boat was made by itself? You know, you could be a big man, a great man according to your people, but we don't accept you such a great person that a tree would get cut by itself and then become sort of in the form of a boat, and then that boat would drive by itself and then bring you here without even you guiding it and no one is driving it. Impossible. So he said, what the debate is all about then? You guys are claiming the whole universe came in existence by itself. There is no God. I'm saying only one boat and you don't believe me. And this is what it is. That if you tell people, you know, I was sitting in my home and I just had a cabinet standing there, and that cabinet came turned into the form of a car and became a nice car, no one would believe you. So subhanAllah, all of these things in the whole universe, the way the whole universe is running, just came into existence without anything, without anyone building it, without anyone taking care of it, without anyone maintaining it, and it's running for years and years in such a smooth system. The sun, moon, stars, and the globe, the whole globe, the way it turns, and everything is going in its perfect shape and perfect form. All of this is just all of a sudden, it just came by nature and got into existence without anyone creating it. Impossible. So everyone really understands there is a creator. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inviting us. U'budu rabbakum. First thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited us towards worshipping Him. That come and worship Him and worship Him without associating any partners with Him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned some signs of His greatness, His existence, of His creation. الَّذِي خَلَقَ جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً. He created the heaven and the earth for you, and He sends the rain water for you, and He brings all kind of fruit from the ground for you. Of course, each and every fruit is a big sign of the greatness of Allah, of the existence of a creator, that from this dirt we are getting such beautiful tree. From a small seed you get a whole tree full of fruit, and every year, every season keeps on giving you new fruit and full of sweet and sweet fruit, full of juice. Subhanallah, all of this is a sign of the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited us towards worshipping Him. Then, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah is inviting us towards believing in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the first thing is tawheed. After tawheed is risalah. Oneness of Allah, and after that is nabuwah, risalah. Believing in the anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited us to believe in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a very unique way. And that is, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي غَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ. If you have any doubt about what we have revealed to our servants, then bring a surah like the surahs of this Quran. And if you can do it yourself, وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Call your supporters other than Allah if you are truthful. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that you think Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made this Quran up by himself? Okay, let's say we accept it for the argument's sake that he made it. Then you should be able to make something similar to this. Then bring something like Quran. And this challenge is presented to those who knew Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from his birth. His own close relatives who were against him, like Abu Lahab, who was his uncle. And we know that Abu Lahab, when he got the news of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's birth, he set his slave woman free who gave him that news. He set her free. And later on then, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started inviting people towards his nabuwa, he was one of the worst enemies of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 40 years, he was supporting him, he was standing for him. All of a sudden, as soon as Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started inviting people to the deen of Allah, to the jannah of Allah, his own uncle became one of his worst enemies. And books of seerah and hadith are full of what type of animosity he had against Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to keep on walking behind Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wherever Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would go. And whenever he would start talking to someone, he would start telling those people, you know, I'm his uncle. This person is mad. This person is out of his, he's insane. He doesn't know what he's doing. And also he's a magician too. I know him. This is my nephew. So don't talk to him. Don't listen to him. And imagine when a person's uncle who says, I know him from the time he was born, would start telling people, don't listen to him. Don't worry about what he's telling you. Don't even listen to him. And then he starts cursing at Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in front of everyone. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, salat al-rahim, joining the relation, he doesn't want to say a bad word about him, about his uncle. He doesn't want to misbehave. He doesn't say anything. He would just leave and go away. Now he keeps on following. Wherever he goes, he keeps on following. Created a very difficult situation for Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And people like him now are being challenged that if you think he's not a true prophet, then make a surah like a short surah of Quran. These people knew what type of education he got, where did he study, where he went, where he traveled, who are the people that he met. They knew, they had his whole history in front of him. These are not the people who can claim he sits home and keeps on making it up. He keeps on writing it up. There would be so many drafts of Quran. Of course, imagine when you just write a small booklet, and if anyone has any experience in writing a book or booklet, you really would know what this means. It's not easy. It takes time. And you write a book, and then you revise it, and you have to make changes to it, and you keep on making changes. And another draft, and third draft, and fourth draft, and then show it to some people who can change, who can see if there are any mistakes, any contradictions, there is anything wrong, there is any misquotation. There has been so many things. And here, there is no library. He is not sitting in a library and going back to all, referring to all those books. And at the same time, he is not traveling all around the world and meeting those people who have knowledge so he can get all of this knowledge. They say he was very sharp, very extremely extraordinary memory. He memorized everything he heard from people around the world and he came back and he started writing it down. So people of Makkah, they knew that none of this is true. So now, those people are told that, okay, you think he made it. He just came up with it all of a sudden. Then فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّمْ مِثْلِهِ. You bring a surah like this one, and bring all your supporters. Anyone who can help you, can support you, bring them to help you with it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenges them. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا. But if you do not do it. وَلَمْ تَفْعَلُوا. And you will never be able to do it. Subhanallah. Who would dare to present a challenge like this one? Even today, if someone would write a book, after a lot of research and after a lot of time having spending time on some topic, collecting all the material from all around the world, still that person would not be able to tell the world that no one would be able to write a book like my book. And here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Quran, فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا, if you cannot do it, وَلَمْ تَفْعَلُوا, you will never be able to do it. فَاتَّقُوا النَّارِ, then guard yourself against the hellfire. Which means now, the only explanation of you not believing in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that you are being stubborn, you don't want to follow the haq and trust. Otherwise, it's very clear, he did not meet it. He himself is saying, see, when a person would make something very unique, he likes to be admired for it. He likes to get the credit for it. You know, here, look at what I did. In fact, so many times, some other people would do it, and we would just touch it. And we'll say, look, I did it too. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after writing this whole Quran, he would come to the world and say, Allah wrote it? No, why would I say that Allah wrote it? I wrote it. It's a very unique work that I have done. I like to get the credit for myself. What benefit I'm getting by saying Allah wrote it? In fact, I would have a better name in my public, in my people, by saying I wrote it. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no, I didn't write it. No, you wrote it. I didn't write it. You made it up. I don't have that knowledge to write it. You people know that I never learned how to read and write. الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَ الْأُمِّينَ. What does الْأُمِّي mean? Normally translated as illiterate. But really, it means a person who has no other teacher than his own mother. That's it. A person who didn't learn reading, writing, or anything from anyone other than his mother. So the only teacher he had was his mother, Ummi. Referring to the mother. He didn't go to a school, he didn't go to college to study all of this. So, people knew that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doesn't know how to read and write. He never went to a college, to a university to learn all of these different type of sciences that are in Quran. So of course, there was only one explanation to it, and that is what he's saying is true, that it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now imagine people who are trying to fight him. They are coming into the battlefield to fight Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, spending millions of dollars. And I'm talking about those days and then continued even afterwards. And sacrificing their rest, their comfort, their life too, to oppose Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to try to defeat Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What was so difficult for them just to come up with a short surah like the surahs of Quran? If you really believe he's wrong, he's not right, he's making it up, and what the deen he's presenting is not really the deen of Allah, and that's the only reason we are opposing him, because he's lying. So okay, make a surah like the surah of Quran, very simple, make a short surah, and then you have proved him wrong, that's it. You don't have to go into the battlefield, you don't have to fight, you don't have to spend no money, nothing. That's it. It's done. He made it very easy for you. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he did was, he wrote the shortest surah of Quran. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar, fa salli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. And he had someone write it and hang it on the Kaaba, that if anyone thinks that I'm not a true messenger of Allah, I'm making it up, then just bring a surah like this surah of Quran. That's it. You don't have to make something like Surah Baqarah or Surah Al-Imran. Not even like something قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. That is still too big for you guys. Just bring something like إِنَّا عَتَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ. No one was able to do it. He's challenging the Arabs, those who were masters in the language. And in fact, we see that they used to call non-Arabs Ajam. And you know what Ajam means? Ajam means the person whose dumb. He cannot speak. The animals are known as ajam. They don't have a language. So Arabs used to call non-Arabs ajam, which means you don't have a language. What a language do you speak? Is this a language? To them, any language other than Arabic language was not considered even was not even worthy of being called a language. This is why they used the word ajam for non-Arabs. And really, if a person is aware of the beauty of the language, of the depth of this language, you would see that in reality, what they believed was true. That every language in comparison with Arabic language is really ajam, is not worthy of even to be called a language. The way how Arabic language can accommodate the feelings, this is something very important, the feelings of human beings, not just the general meaning of what you like to convey, it's even the feeling. The Arabic language, they say that every word has a special temperature to it too. You know just why? Hot, very hot, not too hot, warm. Arabic language, the words have a temperature to them. That word, by the use of the word, you can tell the temperature of the person's feeling. What his feeling is regarding that. When he uses the word, if he knows what word to select, and he's selecting that word, then you really know that this person, this is what he's trying to say. A very deep language. A little difference in the vowel of fatha and kasra will just change the whole meaning. A little change in the formation of the word, adding one letter, subtracting one letter, will just change the meaning of the whole word. It's a very deep language. Of course, this is not the time, inshallah, if there is time, we can talk about the beauty of this language and the depth of this language. Very beautiful. So those people, they were well aware of this language. And they were masters in it. They knew all of these details of the language. They never studied. But this was something that was part of their culture. Young children in that community, they knew poetry right and left. They would look at the heaven and they would make a whole poetry, 100 poems. A young girl, 7, 8 years old, will make poems, 100 poems about just the skies and how the sky, yeah, how she sees the skies at this time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with that. And they were proud of it. They kept it. And those are the people who were challenged by Rasulullah, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِّثْلِهِ. Bring a surah like the surah of Quran, and you have proved me wrong. That's it. If you bring a surah like Quran, I would admit that I'm not a prophet. What more do you need? Now he presents the surah, إِنَّا عَطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِيَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرُ. And he says, just bring a surah like this one. And no one is able to bring it. No one is able to make anything like that surah of Quran. That was a clear sign that they admit that he is a messenger of Allah. There was no way for them to be able to reject it. Let's go further with it to understand this ayah now, the implication of ayah in our day and age. Was this challenge only for those people, for those Arabs who knew the language at that time? No. The challenge continues until this day, until the day of Qiyamah. The challenge have not ended by the end of that era. It was not only for the Arabs of that time. It's for the whole world to come till the day of Qiyamah. That وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِّثْلِهِ. If you are in doubt of what we have revealed to our servants, then bring a surah like the surah of Quran. challenge to the whole world till the day of Qiyamah. Now, all of a sudden we will have someone who would say, you know, yeah, I'm able to make something. I made something. I brought something. For that, you need to understand what is the miraculous nature of Quran. What makes it so miraculous? Why Quran is so unique? What is there in Quran that really prevents people from making anything like it and everyone realizes that I cannot do it? What is there in Quran? In reality, if we look at it, everything of Quran is of that nature. Every letter of Quran is of that nature. But for us to understand it and make it simple so that we can see the miraculous nature of Quran, one is the language of Quran. That for sure is miraculous, and the challenge through the language exists till the day of Qiyamah for sure. And when we say the language of Quran, selection of the words, formation of the ayahs, the method of presentation, the way of presenting the message in totally different and unique way. Everyone has a message, and you can present the message in different ways. Quran has a very unique way of presenting the message. And as I said, there is a temperature to it. When the message is presented to sinners, you would see different words used. When the message is presented to kuffar, then you would see different type of words that are more strict are used. When the message is presented to those who are kuffar and they are rejectors at the same time, they don't want to believe, then the message is presented in totally different way, very strong way with some proof. Let me give you a very simple example, something that we all would understand now, keeping this in mind, that the way of presenting the message. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Yasin, common surah that we all study, hopefully we all read it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا أَصْحَابَ الْقَرْيَةِ إِذْ جَاءَهَا الْمُرْسَلُونَ. Give them the example of the people of the town, whatever town that was. Allah did not mention the name of it. إِذْ جَاءَهَا الْمُرْسَلُونَ. When the messengers went to that qarya, to that town. إِذْ أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِمُ اثْنَيْنَ. When we sent two people to that, to the people of that town. فَكَذَّبُوهُمَا. They rejected to believe in these two messengers. فَعَزَّزْنَا بِثَالِثٍ. We strengthened these two by sending a third one. Two messengers are sent, people rejecting them, they don't want to believe in them. Another one is sent, so three messengers sent at the same time now. فَكَذَّبُوهُمَا. They rejected those two messengers. فَعَزَّزْنَا بِثَالِثٍ. We supported these two with the third one. What did these messengers say to them? فَقَالُوا إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ مُرْسَلُونَ. Now, look at the formation of the word. They said, إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ مُرْسَلُونَ. Surely we have been sent to you people. These people's response was, مَا أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُنَا. You are just a human being like us. وَمَا أَنْزَلَ الرَّحْمَنُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Allah have never revealed anything. You claim to receive wahi, there is nothing such a thing. إِنْ أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا تَكْذِبُونَ. You're only lying. Messengers, now after seeing that these people are not willing to accept and they're calling them liars, what did they say? قَالُوا رَبُّنَا يَعْلَمُ إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ لَمُرْسَلُونَ. The first message was, إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ مُرْسَلُونَ. In fact, then they said, إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ لَمُرْسَلُونَ. The third time when they rejected them, they said, رَبُّنَا يَعْلَمُ إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ لَمُرْسَلُونَ. Message is same. The way of presenting. رَبُّنَا يَعْلَمُ. Our Lord knows. Which means I swear by Allah. My God is witness. Then, He knows. إِنَّا. إِنَّا, again, to emphasize on the point. For sure we are. إِلَيْكُمْ towards you. Lam mursalun. Surely we have been sent. Lam is added to there. So the way of presenting the message to different type of people. And then, in addition to this, when the message is presented, is not presented with in a shaky way. Well, it could be this, it could be that. There is a possibility of something being like this, but it could change. No. Firm. And everything is comes very strongly in the most firm way that a person could present the message. This is how it is. There is no change to it, no possible of any changes to it. Now, take an example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking about different type of rides. He says, and keep in mind the rides of those days. Allah says, وَالْخَيْلَ وَالْبِغَالَ وَالْحَمِيرَ لِتَرْكَبُوهَا وَزِينَ. He created the mule and the horses, camel and donkey, so that you can ride them, and it's a way of beauty. لِتَرْكَبُوهَا وَزِينَ. You can ride it, and it's a way of beauty also when you ride a horse, you know, it look good. Okay? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And He will create more rights that you are not aware of yet. وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. He will create more rights that you are not aware of yet. Now if you think of it, okay, maybe a bigger camel, horse with 8 legs, 4x4, but subhanAllah, now just think about وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ and look at the different type of rides that are available in the world. How did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam know that so many different type of rides will be created? وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that he comes so firmly to claim and to say that so many different types of rides will be created that you are not even aware of. And today, me and you are told, وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that so many others will come into existence that we are not even aware of it. So the way the message is presented in the most firm method, with full strength, without having a shaky message in the Quran, no, firm. And then, if you go into more details, then you see the stories of the previous nations. How did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam know all of those details of the previous nations? This is why some people think now, who claim that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it up. They would say, he stole those stories from the previous books, Torah and Injil. He stole this information from Torah and Injil. Subhanallah. A person has to think, be in his mind before he makes any claim. He is sitting in Arabia. And he doesn't have access to all of those books, to all of those stories. He's not learning those books over there. But okay, yet when you are making a claim, then you have to know what you're saying. Are these stories of Quran really exactly the way they are in Torah and Injil? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Quran that we have sent Quran wa muhaymina alayh. This Quran takes care of the previous books, which means anything that was changed, that was wrong over there, Quran corrects it. And whatever is correct, Quran preserves it. If you look at these stories of the previous nations that are in Quran, number one, you would find so many things that in the previous books are not correct. They cannot be correct. But the way Quran presents it, it's in a most correct way, and it's proven that this has to be the right way. Number two, the other difference. Quran gives details of things in those stories that were not there in those books. Sometimes Quran disagrees with some of the things mentioned in those books and presents the fact that exactly of what exactly happened in that, in that situation. So Quran does not just repeat those stories. The Prophet ﷺ translated the stories from those books and he just put them in here. No, no, no. You find some extra information. Number two, you find some different information, additional information, and sometimes you even find information that goes totally against what was over there, and Quran presents totally different reality. And the reality, the way it's presented, it's in such a way that when a person would look into those books, will have to agree that this has to be the truth. Let me give you a few simple examples to understand this point. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Quran, when he talks about Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, what was the Jewish view about Isa alayhi salatu wasalam? A person who falsely claimed to be Prophet, walayyazu billah, and we killed him because of that. We crucified him. What was the Christian point of view? Son of God was sent to invite people towards God, and people crucified him. Quran says both of them are wrong. He was not son of God, and he was not a person who just made it up. He was a true messenger of Allah. If this is what we find in those books, no. Then Quran goes beyond that. What really happened? Subhanallah. You can say, okay, no, this is what the belief is. But what really happened? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes into that detail also and tells us, وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. They did not crucify him. They did not kill him. And a resemblance of him was presented to them. See how Quran tells us the facts. So it's not agreeing with what happened over there. Telling us that that information is not correct. And this is the right version of it. This is the right, the correct information. Quran is speaking about Musa alayhi salatu wasalam being in Egypt and dealing with the rulers of Egypt. What does Quran say? Who was the ruler of Egypt? Fir'aun. Musa alayhi salam was dealing with Fir'aun. Then Quran speaks about Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. That Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, during his time, he was also dealing with the ruler of Egypt. He was in Egypt and he was dealing with the ruler of Egypt. Who was the ruler of Egypt? Quran says, Al-Malik, king. Doesn't say Fir'aun. Nowhere in the story of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, the word Fir'aun is used is always Al-Malik, the king. Nowhere in the story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, the word Malik, king, is used for the ruler of Egypt, always Fir'aun. People didn't know why. And no one even paid attention to it, really. Until around the year 1700, when people started coming up with the word, you know, they always find some new pieces of stones and writings and these type of things. So then, as they started collecting all of these, they came up with, they had a lot of those writings, but they were in totally unknown language. So it was a language that was spoken in those days, but they didn't know how to translate them, they didn't know what it means. But of course, you know, the museums, they love to have these type of unique things. So they used to buy them for millions of dollars and keep them in the museum. That was the only purpose they would keep it. They don't know what it means, but keep it over there. Then, about 100 years ago, a little older than that, they found another writing. Amazing.